Hi,
I'm Michael Correa, and this is Psych Exam Review. And in this video, I'm going to talk about significance. And significance is an inferential statistic. So unlike the descriptive statistics, which simply describe our data, inferential statistics allow us to make judgments and inferences about what our data might mean. Now, when we use the term significance, we're not using it the way you use it in everyday life, to say that you have a significant workload or a significant other. In research, when we use the term significance, we're saying that the data meets certain mathematical criteria. Now, there's a number of ways to calculate significance, and we're not going to get into the calculation in this video, but I am going to talk about the factors that influence whether data might be significant or not. So, what are these factors? Well, one of them is the effect size. And all that the effect size refers to is how large is the difference that I found between my experimental group and my control group. So it's the difference between the experimental group and the control group. So let's imagine that I told you I invented a smart drug. And I said, okay, I'm going to test my drug with a group of students. So I give half of the students the drug and the other half a placebo, and then I measure their results on some exam. And I tell you that the drug group had an average score of 88, and the placebo group had an average score of 87. I say, look, my smart drug worked. You'd say, well, maybe, because this effect size is really small, and we can't be so sure that it's coming from the drug. So if I were to tell you that the drug group had an average score of 95 and the placebo group had an average score of 30, then you might be more intrigued to find out more. You might say, well, this drug might actually be doing something because we have a much larger effect size. But it's not effect size alone that matters. We also need to know about the sample size. And that refers to our number of participants. So if I told you a student took this drug, scored a 95, another student didn't take the drug, scored a 30, you'd say, okay, but that's only two participants. That's a really small sample. It could be the case that the student who was going to get a 95 happened to be the one who took the drug, and the student who was going to score poorly happened to be in the control group, and so this could have just happened on its own. It's not necessarily the drug. But if I told you I had 1,000 students who took the drug and they averaged 95 and 1,000 students who didn't and they averaged 30, now you'd see that this data is more convincing. So with sample size, we tend to follow the idea that bigger is always better. And this is referred to sometimes as the law of large numbers. And this is the idea that the more participants we have, the better, the more confident we can be in our data. Okay, so let's see what significance actually looks like. When we calculate the significance, which we're not going to do now, we come up with a p-value. And what a p-value tells us is how likely it is that our data would occur. Right, so it's saying that is the data we collected likely to happen on its own or not? How much could chance be playing a role in these results? And what we want is we want very unlikely data. Right? We want data that doesn't just happen. We want to have a situation where it's unlikely for this to happen and it happened anyway. That's more interesting to us. So we usually set the p-value. In order to say something is significant, it means that the p-value is below 0.05. And in some cases, we might need to be more strict with our p-value. You may see cases where people want to see the p-value below 0.01 or even 0.001. But generally, significance is a p-value lower than 0.05. So what exactly does this mean? Well, let's imagine a scenario that I gave you a fair coin, and I told you that I had the ability to mentally control this coin. And when you flipped the coin, I would make sure that it landed on heads. Now imagine that you flipped this coin once and it landed on heads. What conclusions would you draw? Well, you probably wouldn't be willing to say that I had mental powers yet. You say, okay, that's interesting, but that's likely to occur on its own. I mean, if I flip a coin and you're not even here, the odds of it landing on heads, 50%. So I'm not convinced that you have mental powers. I'm going to want to see you do it again and again and again. And each coin flip that you add makes the data become less and less likely to occur on its own. So if you flip the coin 100 times in a row and it's heads every time, and I'm telling you this because of my mental power, now you might be more intrigued. And if you did it 1,000 times in a row, it'd be even more interesting. Now you could say, of course, this is still a possibility. It is true if you flip a coin 1,000 times, it's possible that you'll get heads every time just by chance, but it's very unlikely. And if you did it 1,000,000 times, again, it's unlikely, but it could happen. And each flip basically makes it less and less likely to happen, but you'll never get to zero. So we'll never be able to say the p-value is zero. It could be 0.00000, you know, hundreds of digits long, but it's never going to get to zero because there's always a chance that that data could happen on its own. Okay, so the important thing to remember about a p-value is even when p is less than 0.05, like in our coin flip example, let's say I did it 100 times. So, okay, it could be chance, but it's very unlikely. This doesn't tell us why it's happening. And this is a really important point for thinking about significance. Is that the p-value tells us that the data is unlikely, but it doesn't tell us how or why the event is occurring. It just tells us it's a very unlikely event to observe. All right, so this is really important because when we see a low p-value, it doesn't mean that the hypothesis is correct. The hypothesis is just the possible explanation for this data, but the p-value doesn't know what the hypothesis is. The p-value just says it's unlikely for this to happen. So no matter how many times you flip the coin, that doesn't prove that I have mental powers. That's just the explanation that I'm giving you, but the p-value doesn't tell you if that explanation is correct. The p-value just says, well, this would be really, really unlikely to happen on its own. So keep that in mind whenever you think about a p-value. It just tells you this is unlikely. This is probably not chance, but it could be still, but it's very unlikely for that to happen. But it doesn't tell us anything about the hypothesis. It doesn't tell us how or why the event is occurring. It could be mental powers controlling the coin flips, or it could very well be something else. And the p-value isn't going to be able to answer that question. I hope you found this helpful. If so, please like the video and subscribe to the channel for more. Thanks for watching.